opportunity.
I would love to go first. Madam Chair and members of council, my name is Chris Vesper. Lisa, I don't think you have paper presentations. Everybody have it?
They have.
Okay. What I would like to do is go through the follow-up items that were requested as a result of our presentation in November. And there were five items that I have on the list. The last one is more of a tax question. It says, what's the five-year impact on city revenues for nonprofits? That's not a utility question, but I prepared to speak to the other four items.
Okay.
The first question is, what is DPU's plan for collecting delinquent payments? And my assumption on that was, that was for stormwater. Because again, at that time, that was when we had made the decision that we need to start doing something because our arrearage was getting much higher than the standards that we wanted to be. We had done a presentation in November. We reprinted that presentation out. It's a five-page presentation. And if you would like, I can run through it very briefly, or if you just have questions with regard to it, I can answer questions out of hand, however you feel best. If you'd like a refresher, I can, you know, probably run.
Well, if one new member, if you have any good idea.
Sure, okay.
Two new members.
To give you some, just some background information, of course, we have a stormwater utility, which we collect a fee based on impervious area. And what's happening over, the utility has been in place for 3 years now, and our uncollectible rate has been increasing as time has gone on, and now it's gotten to a point where we need to actually start taking collection action. Given the economic times that we were in when the stormwater utility was created, we wanted to give our residents a break, so we didn't take harsh collection action, but we do need to do something to collect the revenue that is owed us. So we've developed a strategy, and that's what we're going to do. Probably the primary thing that we think is going to get us where we need to be is to stop our policy of sending an annual stormwater bill, which is a separate bill to our residents and of course all businesses and everybody that lives in Richmond, property owners, and move that to the utility bill. One of the things that we found is a best practice for localities that we've looked at that have stormwater utilities is those that put it on the utility bill tend to have higher collection rates. So you can see from the first dot point, two that happen to be in Virginia have substantially higher collection rates than we do. Virginia Beach is as high as 99.8% of the money that they bill they collect. We're somewhere in the upper 70s, so you can see our performance is below that. The other thing that we want to do is we want to give people the opportunity to make payment arrangements, and we, I guess, I don't know if it's technically an amnesty program, but if people make a payment arrangement prior to us rolling this out and putting the bill, the fee on the stormwater bill, on the utility bill, what we would do is we're going to forgive late fees, any interest charges or whatever, and we'll work with people to make any kind of payment that they can afford, whether it's equal monthly payments, a quarterly installment, it's whatever they can afford. So we want to work hand in hand with the resident or the whoever the project owner would be to help get them caught up, and if they work with us, then we'll waive, as I said, any fee that would have otherwise been incurred. On page three, this is our strategy to notify customers. One of the things we found was customers, let me back up. We called a number of customers, I believe it was somewhere around 600, and one of the things that we heard was they said, I didn't even know I owed a stormwater fee. So one of the things that we found was we need to do better education to our residents, that there is that fee. So what we're going to do is the billing for 2012 in November. Next week, we're going to send a second notice, and we timed it in 60-day increments. It's going to be a second bill, and it says, you've not paid your bill yet, please don't forget you owe us the money. And then in March, April timeframe, we'll do it again, a third notice. And again, that's just to educate people and show them that we have billed them, you've not paid us, and in the hopes that they will call us and try to make arrangements so we can collect.
Chris, can I ask you a question here? Is this when you say include past due notice in the November 2012 billing? I am a little confused. Do you mean to put it on the utility bill?
No, it's not going to go on the utility bill until what would turn out to be the end of calendar year. This calendar year, 13. This is just going to be still a standalone bill.
Fiscal year.
What slide four talks about is, well, what happens if somebody doesn't pay? What actions would public utilities take? And what we've given you is what we think are the three scenarios. The first scenario is a property owner that doesn't pay, that does not have an existing utility service. So I'll give you an example. Somebody that owns property here, it's rental property, but they live out of state. And the utility bill is in the name of the tenant. In that particular case, we're required to bill the property owner. That's in charter. So we would send a notice to the property owner and say, you owe us this money. If they don't pay us, then we would charge them late fees, and we also have the ability to assess the needs. If there's a property owner in the city who does have an existing utility bill, but they don't occupy the dwelling, one of the things that we didn't want to do is we didn't want to penalize the tenants, because they're not responsible for payment of the fee, it's the property owner. So what we would do in that case is we would charge the property owner late fees, and we would also put liens on the property as well. But there would be no action taken against any tenants. And then the third possibility that could happen is you would have a property owner that does have a utility bill and they occupy the building. And what we would do in that case is we would certainly charge them the late fees, and then we would follow our hierarchy for typical DP collections. For instance, if somebody didn't pay their water bill, we have a policy in place as to what actions we can take, and we would follow that same process. The other thing that we're trying to do is we're trying to make it easier for residents and property owners to pay their stormwater fee done is we've expanded opportunities or ways for them to make payments, and I won't read you the list, but there's both electronic means to pay as well as face-to-face ways to pay. And those are listed in 5. We're trying to create as many payment channels as we can for our residents and property owners so that we give them as many options to make it as easy for them to be able to pay as possible.
And Mr. Dean, can you help me with the bar?
Given this combined billing projection, I think you outlined clearly that we should experience a higher capture rate of the billing amount due to this based on the experience of most of the country. Do you have any idea of the cost savings for not sending out the additional mail for that stormwater bill? You're not projecting any cost savings?
We've not projected cost savings because as of July 1st, we're going to go to the utility bill, which is a monthly bill that we would set out anyway. So we really wouldn't, going forward after July, there wouldn't be any cost savings because we send monthly utility bills, and this will just be another line item on the utility bill.
I think the question that might be to clarify is we send out an annual stormwater utility bill to every resident of the city. If we no longer have to send that bill, how much money is the utility going to save?
Basically what you're asking, what does it cost to send that one time bill out?
Approximately $50,000.
I don't know if you heard that. It was approximately $50,000.
Any questions? Yes. What action are you going to take between now and going to the utility bill to notify our customers that they should anticipate seeing this stormwater fee on their regular utility bills? Are you going to try to prepare them for this change-up that we're doing?
Yeah, it's my understanding that we'll be doing obviously a lot of public outreach, whether it's through building service, we're more than willing to go to communities, neighborhood meetings, and explain the process. Those are the two that I'm aware of. I don't know about.
Let me a follow up question in relationship to this. You may have already said that. When we go to the utility bills, are they going to be getting a charge like on a monthly basis? If you're doing two billings now, you're only getting six months of billing. So when we go to utilities, are we going to be doing monthly billings?
Okay. Yes, right now, actually, it's one bill. So if your stormwater fee is $25, you would get a separate bill as if you owe the stormwater fee of $25. What we're going to do is prorate that each month, so the fee would be $2 a month.
In District for Bob's being said, you're going to follow up to what you want to say. And then, as I think that a lot of times, part of the problem is that people don't know what's coming and all of a sudden it's there and they're like, what is this? And so, we don't know what we do, a lot of that we do. A lot of people do not look at those very nice little things with their building bills. And I would hope that before July, since it's part of pointing out that they say $50,000, maybe we can put something in the newspaper or the two newspapers, giving people a heads up. I just think the surprise element is what gets us.
Your point is well taken. We need to do a very, very good job of public education so that for first of all, when people get that fee, it's a new fee, and they'll say, hey, what is this? And obviously that would generate a call, center, but probably more importantly than that, it causes confusion among the residents. So what we want to do is, to your point, is make sure we have a good public outreach.
This budget process also includes cost of service for the other three utilities too. Plan a very robust campaign to allow to talk to everybody as much as you can, not only on the changes you see on the stormwater on the utility bill, as well as everything that we have learned, everything that we're going to communicate to people about and to raise for the other three utilities. We're going to be on the road most of the spring, leading up to the end of the fiscal year. So we are going to talk to everybody and anybody that we can talk to. And that not only includes residents, but also includes Chamber of Commerce and business groups that want to meet with us. We will make ourselves extremely available. You mentioned the print ads. We've got print ads planned. We've got the radio ads planned. We're going to try to do everything we can to reach everybody. But I can tell you, as of July 1st, this will be a call for the call center about what it is. But we will be very, very
I just want to make sure that I understand in the first bullet slide that you talked about providing opportunity for customers to make payments or payment arrangements before consolidation occurs. This is part of the trying to collect all the delinquent dues that people owe the city. Is that an amnesty program? Is this something that are they still accruing the late fees and fines, and then all of a sudden, you know, they can either pay those today or they're still going to have to pay them tomorrow? How do you expect that program to work?
The customers that aren't paying and haven't paid are accruing late fees and interest charges. And what we're saying is, if you call us up and make an affordable payment arrangement and get caught up by July 1st of 2013, we will waive those fees and interest charges. And so what we're trying to do is give people financial incentive to call us to make a payment arrangement. So we would just waive those and any fee that had accrued over the life of the utility.
That's an amnesty.
I'm calling it an amnesty program, but yes, we're trying to give a financial incentive for people to call it.
Okay, thank you.
The second question that we have is, why does DPU need 60 days after the quarter end to report collections? I will stay here and make a commitment to you. First I'll tell you, we do need 30 days from the time our cycle closes to gather the information and put it together in a meaningful format. But what the requirement is that stormwater collection table, which I believe we did hand out, is required to be sent to you along with the quarterly CIP. But we will do everything that we can. Well, not everything we can. We will meet the requirements. So if the CIP report is due on such a date, we will make sure that the appropriate people that give that to you and your staff have the information. We made the commitment that we will get this data in as timely a manner as possible.
Any questions on that? Thanks.
The third one says, it's a DPU requested to provide stormwater reports. I believe we did do that. I'll speak just very briefly about that. Back when this issue came up, to the best of my knowledge, we were, over the course of the 3 years, we front of people, in front of residents and property owners, as part of people to take action and leave action, et cetera. An additional $1 million would be collected up to that point. So that actually, that's the bottom line, so that's a good news story, and we'll continue our efforts to get that as well as possible.
Any questions from you? Once we go, I would think these payments, we would see huge improvement once we start that inventory.
I would think so too, and of course that, we strongly believe that that's the best practice, and that we're following that. And obviously we'll track that, and if changes need to be made along the way, we certainly will. But we do believe putting it on the utility bill is the best thing to do.
Mark?
Given kind of our current rate of delinquency payments and moving forward, one consideration is our equation for doubtful accounts. Because we've got such a backlog here, are we projecting that we're going to start writing off larger amounts if we can't collect them in the near term? And then we get back to some long rate of doubtful account balance.
Fred Burke, Acting Controller of the DPU. We have been very conservative in stating our doubtful accounts, and they've been audited and they've been passed by our city auditors, external auditors who have audited our accounts for the last 2 years. So we're being very, very conservative. If we are with the expected collections we get, we should be able to bring cost back in that we've already at least accrued to be written on. We haven't actually written anything off, but we have set reserves in place that are very conservative. Does that help?
And the last question that I have on my list is, what is DPU's current billing collection policy? And it's a very lengthy policy, and what we did was we boiled that down to something that's more manageable. I believe you have a handout on that. You know, certainly you can read the bullet points, but I think the highlights that I would like to make is we like to be accessible. Well, first of all, you know, obviously we provide a service to our residents, and we expect payment in return for that. That the financial viability of the utility, of course, depends on that. What we're trying to do is create an environment where it's easy to pay. So the second point is we're trying to create ways that people that do electronic banking have electronic means to pay their bills. People that like to carry cash, we have 3 walk-in centers that they can walk in. People that like to write checks every month can do that. Our point is we recognize that different people have a set way that they like to pay their bills, and what we're trying to do is set up an environment where we're amenable to any of those, and that's really what that second dot point is. When it turns out that somebody just simply isn't paying their bill, what we do is we have budget plans, and we encourage everybody to get on a budget plan. As you know, during the winter, when you get into the heating season, if you're a gas customer, obviously, as it gets colder, the bill gets higher. And there are very big fluctuations. And what we encourage our residents to do is to get on payment plans. And what that does is that levelizes the payment, and it makes it much more affordable every month. They can predict every month what they're going to have to pay. if they call in, if they get into trouble, and they get into arrears, all they have to do is pick up the phone and talk to our billing representatives, and we'll work with them to work out a mutual agreeable payment plan. We have two young ladies here with us today that do that for a living, and they are very good at what they do, along with everybody else in the call center. And then what we do is we work with other agencies in trying to get money. We have MetroCare money, we have a fundraiser for that, so that we can help low-income customers. We apply for federal LIHEAP money that we give to low-income customers to help offset their utility bills. So, and we do work with other human service agencies to help with the cost of the bill. Again, when you look at the process, which is the next point down, if somebody doesn't make the payment, we do have a late fee. And that was one of the late fees that I was talking about, that we would waive the stormwater if they pay by July 1st. The first thing that we do is we send out a delinquent notice. Once there's 60 days in arrears, we send a delinquent notice out that says, you're 60 days in arrears, you know, please pay by such and such a date. If they don't, then what we do is we create an order to disconnect this, that particular service that their arrears in. If they still have not paid, then what we do is we place a lien on the house. And if that doesn't work, then we also have firms that we use to go out and help us collect debt.
Any questions?
Mr. Bachelor, I want to shift a little bit to the billing and collection spreadsheet that you shared with us. I have three sheets here. One for 10, 11, and 12. It shows all of the arrearage for those 3 years. Is that what we're looking at?
Yes.
The explanation for the type of structure, I can see a customer, we've got manufacturers, churches, nonprofits, NRO, which is non-residential. What is that? Is that, are those other businesses that would not be classified as manufacturing? Or is it, that's not me, that's multifamily. So are we looking at the businesses at all?
Yes, and that's what the non-residential.
That's what that is.
Yes. Which, and I'm gonna say this, and I'm gonna ask Fred to check with to make sure, but not only is it commercial and industrial customers, it's also state and federal as well.
And explanation a little bit, if you go on the large, medium, and small residential. Is that just based on square footage of the structures?
It's based on impervious area, and the way,
okay.
What the leftmost column is a single family residential small, and we have single family residential medium, single family residential large. What we consider small is a single family residence that has 1,000 square feet or less of impervious area, and their fee is $25. A medium is between 1,000 and 2,500, and that fee is $45 annually. And large is any single family residence that has more than 2,500 square feet of impervious area.
Okay.
And that's 70.
remember when we were looking at the size of meters for water, we had a fixed rate as well. And there was some concern with some of the sizes of meters were in relationship to the cost of the smaller one in relationship to the 2,500 and above. Just something that I think we probably need to just process my mind to make sure there's some equity in the size of the square footage. As well as the overall amount that's being paid for the small areas versus the actual real square footage. Because 2,500 could be up to whatever we don't know necessarily. The other thing that I would like for us to maybe just do some analysis or be paying attention to, and perhaps look at doing some analysis for, as it relates to the delinquencies, which may be corrected with the billing. But there are in certain districts, I know Ms. Cramer brings this up often as it relates to certain districts, typically the homeowners as well as the businesses perhaps that are located in certain districts in the city, because the city is such a divided community, and that some neighborhoods and some districts have a disproportionate share of people of lower income and businesses as well that fall within the category of their gross sales and so forth being quite different. And it would be good if we could look at this past 3 year of delinquency and see if there is a obvious that based on the economic per capita of the specific communities or districts, if there is a tendency where we see some relationship to communities. And if there is, that whether or not there's some other kinds of considerations that may need to be made in addition to.
We can line that daily.
Appreciate it. I suppose I have two questions. One is, in the non-residential, the schools fall into that?
Yes.
And so yes. Richmond Public Schools pays for anything?
Richmond Public Schools is built for stormwater utilities.
Right. And my other question, thank you for that answer. My other question is, the state was billed the stormwater.
Yes, the way the charter reads, it says all
is the
property.
Is the state a willing partner in this program?
Yes, actually, and Fred can verify this, but the state actually is doing a very good job, as is the federal government in paying the bills.
I know that was one of the reasons we initially put it in, what was one of the reasons.
Right, and they obviously not every state property has paid it well, but they do have a very good rate.
Thanks. Any questions? Okay, thank you.
Appreciate it.
We're just going forward all our work here.
No problem at all.
Thank you.